song. Waking up to ash and dust, I wipe my brow and I sweat my rust. I'm breathing in the catacombs. So I hear you painting a picture of two kingdoms clashing with each other, yep. And the patron client system maybe is what's being turned upside down. I'm going to overview chapters 4 through 7 and invite comment. And so we see in chapter 4 this picture of heaven and the Lamb in the center of that image. The big question comes up is who's going to open these scrolls? And John's all weepy because nobody's going to do that. And you wonder why someone's so emotional about scrolls being opened or not, but there seems to be much more at stake that if the scrolls are not open, then the problems of the world are never resolved. And the scrolls get open, the seals are broken one by one, and these crazy things come out of the seals. The first four seals break open, and there's these different horses called the horsemen of the apocalypse coming out. And each of them bringing like a picture of the rottenness aspects of the history of humanity. People trying to conquer each other, death as a result, a famine as a result, and then finally a picture of dead people in the underworld. And then you see a counter seal where suddenly you have these people that have been killed by the evil system wearing these robes and waving these palm branches and being completely cleansed. That final scene becomes illuminated as John writes about seeing this huge number of people that belong to God, 144,000.
Chapters 4 through 7 are, I don't know how to put this delicately, the start of the weird part of the book. from here on out, it's very heavily symbolic. I mean, not that the vision of the seven lampstands and Jesus in the seven lampstands isn't also heavily symbolic, but this is where the symbolism hits turbo. The scene of God the Father seated on the throne of heaven is very reminiscent of the vision in Daniel, or the vision of Isaiah, where he talks about seeing a throne in heaven surrounded by cherubim.
Yeah.
And the image is that isn't necessarily literally what's going on in a physical place, heaven. Mm-hmm. It's symbolic of the place where all the decisions are made and all the authority rests.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The throne room is the place in the ancient world where the seat of government is, as well. That's where the king is. So that's where mm-hmm. all the decisions get made. And so John's vision is very much in harmony with the Old Testament idea of a God who is very actively seated. 4 is oftentimes the number of earth. So it's right. The 4 directions, 4 winds. So that is the 4 cherubim.
Mm-hmm.
Is one way to read that symbol is that it's representative of God's power being able to be sent out throughout the entire earth.
Mm-hmm.
The reason that's important is it very much contrasts with the ancient idea world that gods of countries were restricted to that country. The idea that God's power extends in all directions, symbolized by kind of the four winds, 4 directions, 4 angels.
Like, is comparable to images we see in Ezekiel,
yep.
Where you have like the most majestic of creation are the ones who are in God's court surrounding God. But all of these creatures have images that have to do with the created world. Flying eagle, a lion,
eyes,
and then man is one of them. And so the 4 creatures seem to be like the almost a symbol of the worshiping earth surrounding him. And there's this thing where those creatures are worshiping and saying stuff. And then these other creatures are responding to them and worshiping as well. And then you have to ask questions. Well, who are these 24 elders? And the rest of the book seems to address that as well.
The 24 elders are fun because that's the only time I think 24 ever shows up in the Bible is like the right number. You know, usually it's almost always 12 or 7 or 40.
Right.
40 elders would have made more sense, but you know, 24, sure, 24, why not?
Well, so. To me, it's what's irresistible is you have the 12 patriarchs and the 12 apostles. You have the people of God, Old Covenant, people of God, New Covenant.
We can't know for sure any of this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so the admonition on us from the blessing of blessed are you if you read this in the intro is struggle through it as best you can, figure out what is a blessing to you in your understanding of the way the world really works, the way the universe really works. But I wouldn't get so over fixated making sure everything fits, right? The picture is the thing. God talks to John. It's in pictures. He's seeing a narrative flow in his head.
But if we zoom back to the big picture and maybe don't get hung up on the details, we see an image of heaven. We see the lamb, the lion slash lamb, opening up the unfolding of history and kind of an explanation of what's happening in history. And it starts with a lot of warfare and violence, and it ends with the redeemed people of God in complete freedom, complete peace, and worshiping. And it sort of seems to, that final scene in chapter 7 seems to be a preview of the end of the book, where everything is made right. Everybody's okay. And we got through to the other side. One of the questions I had was, where are these four horsemen coming from? Like, are they good or are they bad? And they all seem to be, the voice has come, the angelic voice has come, and they come. So they seem to be under the command, at least, of the heavenly court. And they're all given something. I'm assuming they're given something from heaven, different implements. And that brings kind of the wider question of, when bad things happen, to what degree is God allowing or causing those things to happen?
I think it's pretty clear from the passage that these things may not be happy, but they are fully under the control of the sovereign God on the throne. They are given a thing to do a thing.
Wrestle with the images in 4-7. Don't get hung up in the details. Enjoy the big picture, seeing that things are bad for a while, but like it says in Romans 8:28, they all things work together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purposes.
Keep the faith. You're about to go through persecution. Some of you are going to get thrown in jail and killed, but hang on. I gotcha. This is a direct response to that calling to be faithful unto death, because that's what the ancient, like, that's where the stakes were at this point in the story. I don't have any desire to be martyr. My goal is to make the palm crowd, like, get the robe, wave the palm branch, play in the band. Like, that's it, right? That's my goal. So.